Today's topic: what car is best to buy as an investment, and does such a thing even exist? Now, to illustrate my point, we have here two beautiful red Porsches. On my left, we have this 981 GTS Boxster in carmine red. On my right, we have this glorious 928 GT in Guards. Now, you may have seen this car on the channel already, and I hope to get this one reviewed when the weather improves a little bit. I know it's sunny out there today, but trust me, it is also pretty cold and damp and miserable. So, a lot of people have criticized me for taking too long and waffling a little bit too much in these videos. Well, I promise you, I am going to keep waffling, but I will instead save some of you time by summarizing right now. If you're thinking of buying a car for investment, just stop. Just don't even do it. Seriously, I don't think such a thing exists anymore. The reality is that if you'd bought, let's say, this car 5 years ago, you'd have made quite a bit of money on it. And this is what's happened. People have seen cars rising in value, and they've made the assumption that this is something that's going to keep happening. Well, it isn't. A few months ago, I made a video talking about 911 GT3 prices and what was going on with those. Well, it turned out since I made that video that what I predicted was going to happen did happen. The prices of those cars have started to fall dramatically. And what happens in the car market is that large groups of cars will be led by particular examples. So, in the Porsche world, the iconic car was always the 2.7 Carrera RS. And when those started to go a bit crazy, they dragged up the prices of all the cars around them. This will happen with all sorts of cars. You know, in the Ferrari world, it's always going to be stuff like, let's say, the 250 GTO will set the benchmark. And if you've got a car that's always worth, let's say, I don't know, a tenth of what a 250 GTO is, well, when the 250 GTO rises in price, so will the other car. And this happens when they fall as well. Car values do follow a lot of trends. And it's very hard to predict what those trends are going to be. We do have a lot of issues at the moment in terms of what's actually going to happen to these cars in the next 20 to 30 years anyway. If you're looking at a real serious long-term investment, well, if you're in a country where in, let's say, 15 years, it's suddenly going to cost you £5,000 a year in tax just to own one of these, well, they're not really going to be a very desirable investment, are they? In the UK, we have something called capital gains tax. It means if you own an object and it appreciates in value and you sell it, you pay a tax on that money that you've made. Now, capital gains tax does not apply to privately owned vehicles. This is one of the reasons in the UK that a lot of people with a lot of money decided to stick it into cars. And I think a lot of them are starting to leave that marketplace. Now, you've got modern classics like this 981 here, and you've got proper classics like this, and of course you've got vintage vehicles, you've got cars of all sorts. And the main piece of advice I'd give to people that are looking at buying something for an investment is buy something that won't make you sad if it turns out to not be much of an investment. If you're looking at something like, for example, this 928, and you're thinking, wow, I really, really want one of those. I've always wanted one of those. You know, I saw Tom Cruise in Risky Business. He had one of these, or his dad had one, I think. And he's like, and I always, always needed to have a 928. And, you know, maybe you've done well and you've got the 40, 50 grand it's going to cost to get you a really nice 928. And you want to buy one. And you can afford to run it and you can afford to maintain it. And let's just say it loses 10 grand over the next 3 years. You're not going to be upset about that. Well, you should do it. You should absolutely buy it. And that's the main thing here, really. If you want to buy a car to invest in, well, cars have never really been the best, most dependable and reliable way to make money, but they are something that you can certainly enjoy. I mean, I enjoy driving both of these cars. I really, really do. I wish I could afford to have them in my collection, but hey ho, YouTube unfortunately doesn't pay us all as much as I know a lot of you think it does. So if you are out there thinking about buying a car, what are the things to look for if you want to buy a car for investment? Well, in 2018, it was tricky. In 2019, which it is now, it's going to be even trickier. The best advice I can give you is to look at the trends and look at the alternate car. So I mentioned before things like the 2.7 RS. And let's say in the Ferrari world, a classic Ferrari that everybody seemed to love was the 355. It always held its price very, very well. For various reasons, the 348 and the 360 were never quite as loved. So you need to look at trends in the marketplace, look at what cars are becoming interesting or becoming of the moment, and see what people are going to pay for. Now, one thing that is fairly predictable is this cycle of childhood dream cars. Now, this is no doubt going to be changing because people are, on the whole, driving less and less. And with even fewer people actually interested in cars, it's going to make it, well, better or worse, depending on how you look at it, for those of us that are really into them. So every generation has its poster cars. Now, let's take someone from my father's generation. Well, his realistic, real-world poster car was a Ford Capri. You may have seen the video that I've already done with his Ford Capri. Now, if you don't know much about the Ford Capri, it is a Ford coupe made over a number of years, sold all over the world, but sold very, very well in Britain. We absolutely loved it here. Anyone that lived through the 70s or 80s either owned a Capri or they know someone that owned a Capri. Well, about 15 years ago, my father sold the example that he owned back then for about £4,000, and that was a really, really good car. The Capri he's currently got is worth, depending on how you look at it, anywhere between about £20,000 and £30,000. Now, that's an awful lot of money for an old Ford that, when it came out, was a great car, for sure, but nothing special. They were not an uncommon car. They were not a rare car at all. You'd see several of them in every street. But what happened to those, of course, is that they all vanished. And you get to the stage where the only ones that are left are, well, good ones, basically. And you've got a lot of people that are, say, my father's age that all said, oh, I had a Capri, or I always wanted a Capri when I was younger, and now I can afford to buy one. And of course, when there's only a few of them left around, you're going to start fighting to get these things. You're going to start bidding with other people to buy these cars. This is why they go to auction, because people want to get the best price they possibly can for them. And so that will happen. It won't happen with all cars, and there's always going to be bargains to be had, especially with stuff like the Capri. People can get very obsessed with options and specs, and they want the exact version that they want, the exact color that they want. So it's all a bit of a mishmash, and you've got to really understand these worlds to know it. And that's why being passionate about the car you want to buy, I think, is really quite important. Now, there's some other trends as well you can look at, which might be helpful if you really are desperate to find a car that you think will increase in value. One of the things you can look at is vehicles which were not allowed to be imported into the United States. Generally speaking, if a car wasn't sold in the USA when it was new, they have to wait 25 years to be able to import one. So as of right now, vehicles that were made in 1994 or so can now start being imported. So you got things like the Toyota Celica GT4, or as the Celica as they would call it. Those are cars that can now be imported, or early ones, can now be imported into the USA, which means that you might start seeing the prices of those rising. A lot of Nissan GT-Rs were the same, so there's a few GT-R R34s sat in the USA that cannot be road registered, that dealers have got, that they're just waiting on. I mean, the prices of those went kind of nuts recently anyway, but if you've got an R34 GT-R tucked away in a garage in the USA, I'd say that's a fairly safe investment. And a lot of this talk is going to be about that. This is what you've got to do is you're not going to look at a car and think, I'm going to make loads of money on that. But you got to look at a car and think, OK, how much can I lose on it? And of course, the more expensive the car, the greater potential you have to lose an awful lot of cash. Now, let's take things like an E46 M3. People keep talking about those as an appreciating car, a modern classic. And I just am not convinced that that is a wise car to be buying right now if you want to try and make some money on a car. First off, most of the examples out there are not very good. The ones that are, people are asking a lot of money for already, so I think the potential for making money on them is going to be pretty severely limited. If you look at examples of things like the CSL, well, the prices on those already went absolutely nuts and have got to a point which I think the market will not sustain it. And market forces and the market having an appetite for certain prices is a real thing. You know, you'll get cars that will go up and up and up in price and they'll suddenly stop. So the Cayman GT4, for example, that was a car that was about £70,000 to £75,000, depending on how you optioned it, when it was brand new. People were selling those almost immediately for about £90,000 to £100,000, again, depending on their options. A load of people bought them and were then selling them or trying to sell them for about £125,000. That just wasn't going to work. This happened with all the GT3s and GT3 RSs. You know, you got cars that were, let's say, £120,000 new. Someone would buy it for about 150, 160, and they'd then try and sell that for about 200,000. Now, some did sell for that money. There was a period of about 6 to 12 months where everything went absolutely nuts. 911Rs were going up to sort of £1 million, I think I saw one advertised for. I'm now seeing 911Rs being advertised at about £350,000, so they've really, really fallen. Of course, if you bought one at their new price, you're not going to care because the car's still worth double what you paid for it. But if you did happen to pay a serious premium for it, well, it's only going to end one way. There was a story a few years ago, some of you may remember, there was a gentleman in the United States who bought himself a Bugatti Veyron. Unfortunately, Veyrons tanked. They did not hold their money well at all for various reasons I'm not going to go into. And that car unfortunately found itself in the sea. And the clip of it being driven into the sea is online because he didn't know he was being filmed at the time. I'm sure you can guess the rest of the story. It's an interesting saga if you don't know about it. And yeah, I'm sure there's a lot of cars that have been used for nefarious purposes as they've got worth so much money now. Now, as an example of the fact that these cars will not simply keep appreciating in value, you may recall that I made a video about a gentleman who found his old Ferrari after 40 plus years of having sold it. It was a 275, beautiful car, aluminium bodied, very, very rare example, as all Ferraris of the period were. He bought the car for about £2,000 in around 1972. He sold it a few years later for about £4,000. Someone else bought it for about and sold it for about £15,000. Someone then held onto it for quite a long time, saw the values rise, and they sold it for something like £200,000 to £300,000. Then a syndicate of people bought it. I'm going to get onto this in a minute. They bought it for £1 million. They sold it for £100,000. Now, thankfully, there was a syndicate of people. So let's imagine there was 10 guys who each put in £100,000. Fortunately, they only lost £90,000 each rather than one person losing £900,000. But yeah. Also, with the syndicate, with these sorts of things, and I've seen this as a trend, this sort of supercar investment schemes that have appeared, you know, classic car investment schemes and things, and put your money into a classic car. Don't do it. Don't do it. I hesitate to use the word scam, and I'm sure that some of these things are legitimate, but legitimate what? I couldn't say. I am not a financial advisor. I am not financially qualified. I am not a professional to give advice in any way, shape or form. But common sense would tell me to tell you guys to avoid any of these things like a barge pole. Like a barge pole? Don't touch them with a barge pole. That is the thing that I'm after. And I'm not editing this because, you know, there's no other angles. But if you want to make some money out of a car, be modest. Find a car that you're going to enjoy. Find a car from a company that you like the cars. Find something you know the models. You know the history of the example, so you can pick a good one. That's the thing. Be knowledgeable. Don't go and buy something that someone's told you, yeah, go and buy one of these. They're going to be a really good investment. Because also, so many of these cars have got so much potential to cost you a lot of money. Now, with cars that are worth, let's say, £100,000, £200,000, you know, £300,000, if suddenly you've got like a £5,000 bill to fix something, that's fine, it's not a problem. But I am not joking at all. When I know people that have bought cars, imported cars, there was a guy that imported a Dino a number of years ago. He spent about £110,000 on the car, which was a very good price for a Dino. I mean, they're a lot more now. But he spent £80,000 putting the car right because there was so much wrong with it. He bought it sight unseen and just kind of gone for it. And yeah, and go back to the childhood thing, go back to the boyhood thing. So for people that are my father's age, you got stuff like Ford Capris, I suppose you got old Jaguars, E-types are sort of almost a little bit too early actually. then for some generations it'll be the Porsche of the era. You know, there'll be some people out there for whom this is the ultimate Porsche. And of course you'll get people out there for whom things like Carrera GTs and stuff are the ultimate car, but of course they are esoteric. They are a complete other level of attainability. 911s are generally a pretty solid investment, but again, they've gone up in value quite a bit. If I was going to buy a car, I'd probably look at something like a 996. Yes, I know, I have just sold mine, but I had to. I didn't have it for investment. I didn't actually buy it. I took it as part X or something else. You know, a Lotus is a pretty good investment, but it's going to cost you a lot of money. It's not going to depreciate an awful lot if you buy one that's more than about 5 years old, but they're not cheap to run. And let's face it, even if you have, let's just say, something like an E46 M3, it's very, very easy to spend £1,000 on a service on one of these cars, and that could wipe out an awful lot of appreciation if it even happens. And if you happen to buy a car that's got nearly no miles on it, which you might think is a perfect example of a great car, whatever, what if the car's got, like, say, 2,000 miles on it? You can't drive that car. You can never enjoy it. You want something like this that's got some miles on it. So if you've got a car that's got 60, 70,000 miles on it already, you put 4,000 or 5,000 miles on it, it's not really going to hurt the value of the car. In fact, mechanically, actually, you're really going to be doing the car a favour, especially if it is an older car. So, you know, other cars can cost an awful lot more to service. I used to have a BMW Z4 M Coupe, and even back then, and I sold my car about 4 years ago, people were telling me that, yeah, these are an appreciating classic, yeah, they're going to go up in price. I mean, yeah, and you looked at it and you'd say, yeah, it's a great looking car. They never sold very many. And it's got a straight six NA S54 BMW motor, legendary engine. It's got bits off the CSL, you know, manual gearbox. It's a proper sports car. You'd think that would be a great recipe for an appreciating car. Nope. Nope. They're worth barely any more than when I sold mine. And the reality is that what I'd have spent on servicing the car in the interim would have wiped out any appreciation whatsoever. So I don't want to really ramble for too much longer because the comments section does love it when I do ramble. But I just want to give you a few points, a few bits of food for thought as to should you really be buying a car as an investment? I mean, if you want to buy a classic car, please go and do it. And right now, actually, it is a bit of a buyer's market because there are a lot of people that have made some not great investments and spent an awful lot of money on a car and they want to get out of them. And so if you do have the cash to get into something, great. But do not bank on it making money. Of course, things might be different in different countries around the world. I am speaking from the United Kingdom. Now, for all I know, in the next 12 months, both these cars could double in price. Who knows? I mean, this is a great example as well. If you want to look at something that maybe is always going to have investment potential, look at stuff that's last of line. Last of the air cool, for example. Last of the manuals. Last of the naturally aspirated. All that kind of stuff. You know, those are cars that are always going to have a bit of kudos. But if there's loads of them, if there's tens of thousands of them made, they're probably never going to be worth that much money. A Model T is an amazing, brilliant, wonderful machine with such a special history. They're not really worth anything because there's loads of them and they're difficult to drive. So who can say? But I'd love to hear your thoughts on whether you've actually made some decent money on a car, you've lost some money on a car, or what you think might be a hot investment tip. So thanks for listening, guys. I'll see you for the next one. Bye-bye.